Well, I thought I'd make a video this morning with some playing and maybe just speak about playing. I've got loads of other ideas going on, but I've too many irons in the fire is a problem, really. Just get something to drink. I'm so thirsty on this sort of semi-fasted diet. I've been drinking just double the amount of water. And I think that's a very good sign because in physical terms, I was approaching 90 kilograms when I started this, when the awakening struck. And I am now 78. So that's 12 kilograms, which is a lot of weight if you lift up, 12 bags of sugar or something like that. Although not as heavy as the 20 kilo bags of post-crete that I've had delivered this morning, but still pretty substantial. And that will have been mainly fat. And in order to get rid of that, it has to melt into the bloodstream, I guess, and into the urine and to be removed from the body. That seems to make sense to me. I mean, I'm no expert on these things, but it seems perfectly reasonable. And of course, that fat will be carrying lots of toxins that has been stood that it's stored over the years. And so this is the process of purging, really. And it's really important that I continue to drink loads. I'm not fasting completely. I'm really mainly eating less, I think, would be a more proper definition. I'm eating less. And there are a few days when you could call it a fast. But I don't think I've ever done a day when nothing has passed my lips but water. To me, that just seems unduly harsh. I don't like to put myself under any strain because of my great frailty and age. But even that, my, you know, I'm obviously I'm being facetious to some extent, but I am reluctant to undergo any kind of discomfort. And although I end up creating discomfort for myself by my own actions. Perhaps that's a common problem that we do have. But I mean, this process has to be, of course, it's no good, when you do have to walk uphill, basically, if you need to get anywhere. Sooner or later, there's going to be hills and there's going to be thickets. And so that solution doesn't really work in the long run. And I feel anyway that I do need to train my body to respond the way that I want it to. Certainly, if I'm going to go on a wild camping trip, which is what I'd like to do. I can't do what those guys are doing in Australia, where they've actually built a hut in the woods in some really remote place, I suppose, because there aren't any places like that in Britain, really, because there's a lot of nosy parkers. Mind you, I've at the end, my only knowledge of Australia is from the screen. And I am a huge fan of Australian films and Australian, what do they call them, series. I've watched just about everything that comes from Australia. I just like it for somehow. I mean, I'm interested in Australia, what's been going on and how it's treated. Because when I compare the Australian sort of television series to the British ones, there's a marked difference, not in the official in narrative, I think. And the Australian stuff always seems to me to be very, very much supportive of the state, far more so than in this country. Because in this country, already by the 1960s, I think, there were notes creeping in, you know, of they'd allowed this, they'd almost allowed a sort of a flourishing of the opposition through the, stimulated always through the narratives as everything is done. And I didn't see that very much in Australia at all, you know, an absolute obeisance to the state and to its organs and the police seemed to be a very, very widely upheld by all the characters. Anybody who was good, who was portrayed as being good, you know, and one of the lads. And that immediately aroused my suspicion, you know, what kind of mentality has been promoted in Australia. I mean, I'm sure plenty of people are fully aware of all this and have, you know, have awakened to it or have always been awake to it. But, yeah, Australia is interesting to me. I've never been there. When I was living in Oxford, I think that maybe this is the reason I like Australia. When I was living in Oxford, I had two friends who were Australians. They were very rare in those days, Australians. You could count your Australians really on the fingers of one hand if you were very lucky. Not to mention other nationalities, you know, they were quite rare, really, other nationalities back in the olden days. And if you had any of them, they were a great sign of importance, I always thought. But so these Australian guys were brothers, and the one of them was a dealer, and he seemed to be quite, you know, I don't think I ever bought anything off him, or maybe I did through him. I mean, I'm talking about a dealer of drugs, of illegal, you know, of narcotics. But his brother was a prison warden. And the one was the absolute libertine. He was the epitome of a kind of Don Giovanni, live as you will, enjoy everything. Very charismatic man, and he was the older brother, and of course he was the dealer. And the younger brother was quite the opposite in his approach. He was very much, of course, really in favour of the laws, and although I think he did make an exception in the matter of the smoking of joints. So, well, you've got to have exceptions, haven't you? I realised this morning that if I play my chromatic scale and just end on G, it's automatically in the minor key, isn't it? So, that's just automatically calls E minor, you know, so it's just the third. Been interested in scales. I thought, well, there are minor scales. It's a nice scale, and when I decided to play minor scales, I suddenly found that I didn't know them, and I had to work them out. And, you know, I think I've done it now, but there is, you can go up one way and come down another way on a certain minor scale. And I think that's the one. So. Rather than. And I don't know quite why it is. It does sound okay. If you go up with that same interval, it's just a pentatonic and it doesn't sound quite right. But that's... That interval's kind of interesting, you know. So my attention has been focused on different notes and stuff like that. So I find that if I start with scales like that, I'm more inclined when I start actually playing something just for the heck of it to be a bit more melodically creative, should we say, or breaking a bit of new ground. And I ended up playing by mistake in what turned out to be F. And I was playing in the key of F major, I realised, And so I thought, well, I'm in F major, let's see. There are some notes that you can use, But, it opens a different perspective from a melodic standpoint if you start in a new chord. I began to realise it. And playing chords that are like the B flat major, which you wouldn't normally play it, would you? You wouldn't normally use it as a bass chord. But it offers some advantages, I think. Both of those hammer-ons sound okay, don't they? Something like that, I was thinking, it puts you in mind of other things that you can do on the guitar, I think. So, I've been finding it quite helpful to do that. I don't know, maybe other people already play like that, it seems to be quite helpful, help me improve my playing, which is a process which is taking a little while, but, I'm sure it'll be going along nicely. Yeah, so, thinking about Australia, it'd be so nice, wouldn't it, to be able to go out and build a shack in the wilderness. But here, I can just walk out of my door and just sleep outside. I know it's actually illegal to do that, but that's silly. And, you know, I'm sure that can be challenged in the same way that any anti-biblical edict can be challenged, and successfully also, as long as it's challenged on biblical grounds. I don't think the English Crown can oppose the Bible. I don't think so in court. But I could be wrong, you know. I mean, that's a little bit of a conceit. But, you know, the thing is, the Bible has to be brought into question, and very few people will do that. Because it has gained an ill repute in the land, while the vilest writings have been given eminence.